next session of this evening, I suppose, it would be great to bring in your last and form some amendments and ask you some more general questions. And you and I know what Brian said from Shannon referendum campaign and an extent from my referendum. And at those stages, at the Shannon referendum campaign stage, you were a senator. You had been on the Human Rights Commission, you had been involved in marriage equality, since you're the name on the litigation that provoked that issue on the committee on gender. And then you spoke a bit about it yourself. I don't think many people necessarily know that dimension, which is that you and Anne Louise, as two educators and specialists in education, decided to identify where the need was greatest for women's education in particular, and converted your own shed into a workshop space, and provided childcare facilities, and invited women in to work in that space. I mean, that of itself would be a legacy. What in God's name prompted you to do that?
I will answer, actually, I'm thinking of Anne Louise in light of, you know, that you've mentioned her a couple of times, and I think most people know that she passed away recently. But I'm thinking of her especially because she had a very special connection with New Ross. She originally entered the convent, spent about 7 or 8 years, ultimately decided to leave, which was a very radical act in the 60s, early 70s. And when she made that decision to leave and left the convent, she really didn't have a job and not any money, and she got a phone call from a very good friend of hers who said, "You must know where the River Barrow meets the River Nore." And she said, "New Ross, there's your next opportunity awaits you there." And he had managed to organize a job for her in St. Mary's Secondary School. I'll be going tomorrow and spending a couple of years there. And the reason I want to just remember her that way is because in those earlier days, but even as she continued in whatever else she did, including the establishment of En Passant, for her, she would say, motivated her life was the belief that, a quote from a section of scripture, "What will I do for the Lord? What will I do to return all that he has given to me?" And that really motivated much of her decisions. And for myself, I think in coming to Ireland with her, we both were very conscious of the fact that we were highly educated, had a lot of privilege, and we simply wanted to share what we had.
Can I just pick up one thing you said there? You said that she said, "What would we do for the Lord?" And to what extent was spirituality important for her?
It was important for both of us. We were both originally raised as within the Catholic tradition, and continue to carry with us that depth of, I think, a sense of not only spirituality, but the notion, particularly at the heart, I think, of the Christian message that God is love, or that, you know, wherever love is, that's where the divine thrives and survives. And, and there's many, the incredible commitment to campaigning and looking for change in relation to social justice issues, we brought that with us too from that tradition.
But where does the spirituality sit with some aspects of your progressive agenda? I mean, you're quite proud of your progressive agenda, including that on what you call reproductive rights. Where does your spirituality sit with that agenda?
It very much influences particularly the agenda or the commitment to ensuring reproductive rights and the autonomy of women. I think that as part of my understanding of why it's so important is that I believe that that women should have the opportunity to make ethical choices in relation to their bodies and in terms of their pregnancy. And I don't think that's possible in Ireland.
When do you think we'll have a referendum on the 8th Amendment?
I think that we will hopefully have one before the summer. When I was recently in with the new Taoiseach, and we were negotiating, my opportunity to join his government, one of the things I asked him was about his own commitment to holding a referendum, and he said he was, and then more recently he's indicated that he wants to have it and hold it before the summer.
And the Oireachtas Committee, which has been established now to consider the issue after the Citizens' Assembly, is likely to report at the earliest in January. Do you think it's possible to frame a complex legal and political question that would be the referendum and sort all that out and still have time to do a campaign by May and get there in the way before the Pope comes in August, if that's the agenda?
Well, we've never held a referendum in August, have we? So we don't have to worry about that one. But I think it is possible, Noel. I think the Taoiseach is determined. I know and understand that there are a number of other processes also in play, apart from the committee that's considering the recommendations of the Citizens' Assembly, the Minister for Health is starting to take a look at a potential bill in relation to what would be our abortion legislation, if there were a repeal of the Eighth Amendment, and that the Attorney General's office is also beginning to contemplate the wording. So those things have to happen too.
You talk about a republic of equality. Is that a deliberate attempt to contrast with Leo Varadkar's republic of opportunity?
It is. And in fact, although as you know, I spoke a little bit about a republic of equals prior to Taoiseach becoming Taoiseach.
Some inside and outside this hall would say, but where's the equality for the unborn child? What's your answer?
Well, I refer to that in my remarks there, that I know and I understand that there is not and I don't expect that there can be, a consensus around what I would call the moral status of the fetus. We have an acknowledgement of the legal status of the fetus in this country because of the constitutional amendment of the Eighth, which speaks about the unborn. But we don't have consensus in relation to the moral status. And I would say that, obviously in light of my position here, I do not believe, and I think that's what I tried to articulate, that there is an equivalence between the moral status of the fetus and the woman.
We could, in May next year, because I don't think the referendum. I think you're overly ambitious. We might even be here next year talking about the issue of abortion. We could do that for hours. But let me ask you a couple of other questions. I mean, I've watched your political career closely late, and there's one moment I'm not clear on, which is, after the election, all of the independent members of the Dáil, it seems, are locked in a room for 5, 6, 7, 8 days, writing this big convoluted program for government that are going to negotiate with Fine Gael. Then they're not going into government, they might go into government. Suddenly the story breaks. One of the independents has signed up to go into government, again with Andy Kelly and Fine Gael. And that was you. And it was surprising that it was you. I mean, what prompted you, or how did it come about, that you broke from that pact to make the prospect of a Fine Gael government with independence happen?
There's a long answer to that question. But as our time is limited, I'll give you the short one.
Is the short one that he offered you a ministry?
No, absolutely not. This is the short version. The short version is that when I campaign as an independent TD, and people will, those of us who live in the country, will recall at that time there was a yearning for a change, and that the people thought, maybe that change had to do with independence. But the one question I was constantly asked at the doorstep is, what difference can you make? And would you be willing to cooperate with other independents in order, if necessary, in order to participate in government? And I said, yes, if the negotiations were something that I could sign up to and agree to. And I consistently remember that in my ongoing negotiations, really, with
putting the same T-shirt back into the T-shirt office with the Fine Gael party dominant again is changed? Was changed? And would say it wasn't.
With Enda?
You put the same T-shirt, you've been rejected in the election. And you were part of the process, a key part of
it. He was the one who stepped up to the plate to see could he form a government, which eventually became a minority government, which was the first time ever in the country, and that is change.
And you worked with him as a minister for 8 months, a little more, nearly a year.
Yes.
How do you remember him, Lieutenant?
Well, I remember him as an honorable, ambitious, and disciplined man and leader.
What were his weaknesses?
I suppose I could say talk about that now. I don't know. What were his weaknesses?
We're running in mainstream.
Yeah, I know. Exactly. And, well, clearly, if you say weaknesses from my perspective, I suppose what I would say is that, you know, I had disagreements with him in relation to some values and some ideologies. However, I found that even with those differences, that one of his greatest strengths was his willingness to change his mind, particularly in relation to marriage equality.
Is Leo more stubborn?
I have not experienced that yet.
What are your breaking points? I mean, the terms of the abortion referendum, is it funding around childcare? I mean, what are the, you must think that someday you walk into Leo's office and say, I can't do this anymore, I'm out of here.
Yes, and actually the first eight, several months of the ministry, there are many days I thought that, you know, whether I believe that in terms of trying to describe those values and the sense of elements of a progressive vision, whether or not I felt that I, could, in making decisions, particularly outside of my ministry, in an agreement for, let's say, even in the last budget, and the percentage of how much money we would spend on reducing taxes, when I think perhaps they should be stayed at the same level, versus how much we should spend on public services, those kinds of things. So I often wondered, I might not be able to stay. But each time I was able to talk with, negotiate, and come to a compromise, really. If there were some key issues, for example, I think most people are aware, in terms of the Apple tax case, and the government shifted in relation to some aspects of its decision there, because of those kinds of negotiations and discussions. People changing their mind on both sides.
The strange moment then in the life of this government was that you, the independent ministers, and all of us were effectively bystanders while Fine Gael changed its leader, and had this internal contest about a change of leader, and then Leo emerged as Taoiseach. Were you concerned that that would destabilize the government? Were you confident you were going to be part of the government under Leo? What was your take on that?
I wasn't sure about whether it would destabilize the government, to be perfectly honest, though I did, I think as many people, my hope was that it would not. In my discussions with Leo prior to him becoming Taoiseach, a couple of issues that I wanted to make sure that were important to him, they were important to me. I've already described one. The freeing of Ibrahim Halawa was another one. I think he's taken some real strong leadership in that regard. And so I said to him, okay, I would say yes, and I would be willing to work with him to see, to hope that would enable the stability that we were seeking.
And at the very time the government was changing from Enda Kenny's government to Leo Bradford's government, of course, and and the ministers in our final days. And it was a strange moment that Taoiseach was standing in the Dáil announcing the members of the cabinet, including your name, and you weren't in the chamber. And I remember him saying, naming you as a minister again for children, and then adding that we extend at this time our support to Katherine. And some of us do have Anne-Louise was unwell again, but it kind of brought up this must be really serious. At what stage did you have to tell him you wouldn't be there to be renominated as a minister?
Three or four days before she passed away, I rang Leo from the parking lot in front of government buildings to say that he knew, of course, she was very ill, and I said, I've just been told that she's dying. It could be days or weeks. So I just want to let you know that. And he said immediately, you have all of my support, do what you need to do, and we will stand beside you. And 2 days later, I was at the cabinet meeting prior to his election, and I remember standing just at one of the windows looking out the window, and I looked over at the table, and he was sitting down, and he saw me, and he is, as people know, quite a shy man, and he saw me, and he got up, and he came over to me, and he put his arm around my waist, and he just stood there, and said, we'll just stay with you, Katherine.
He told the story at the funeral that she held on until she heard him being nominated again. And I know it's difficult, and we'll move on from that to this question. Who's your favorite cabinet minister?
After the T-shirt?
Which of them do you admire?
I really...
Shane Ross?
And what I'm going to say here now is, because I mentioned one name doesn't mean that there aren't others. But I do admire one of your other guests for the Kennedy School, who's coming tomorrow, the Minister for Finance.
We'll tell him that.
Okay, too.
No, actually, we'll ask him first who he admires.
I won't send him a text.
How long do you think this government will last?
My hope is that we'll get through 2 more budgets at least.
How long do you think this will
be? I think that it could last for 2 more budgets.
What do you want to have done in those 2 years?
Well, my first priority is to ensure that the movement towards what I'm calling a really radical change in our child care structures has been more embedded in throughout the country and get more monies in relation to that. And I think that would be, and particularly as I tried to indicate in my words there, is that it's radical from my perspective, not just because we're spending more money, but because what we're establishing a structure and a way of supporting our children and our families that is progressive and that ensures that it levels the playing field and that every child receives more of an equal start than they do now.
And over the summer, I noticed that addition in childcare, those additional child care welfare and support schemes kick in September, this September, to go back to school. But I noticed over the summer a juggernaut of the Fine Gael social media campaign claiming credit for that. Did you?
I noticed that too.
Did that annoy you?
A little bit.
What did you do about it?
My team, we were proactive. I mean, we knew it was coming. We were out there first. We just watched it happen, and then we came out and added, some more things about what we're doing.
How do you get on with Shane Ross?
He sits next to me in cabinet. Right,
how do you get on with Shane Ross?
Well, I think that we've developed a respect for each other over the last year.
Not a fondness, just a respect.
Well, I have respect for him, yeah.
And there have been very few women in the Irish cabinet, ever in our history, too few. There have been very few politicians who've been appointed a minister on their first day. You are the second American-born person to sit in the Irish cabinet, Eamon de Valera, of course, being the first. But you're one of the few who was elected, made a minister on their first day in the Dáil, one of the few women. Do you know who Neil Brannan is? Many in the audience might even remember who Neil Brannan was. She was a female minister, appointed on her first day in the Dáil, did the iconic thing like abolish third debtor fees, and was a one-term Dáil deputy having lost her seat. Do you fear that?
That might happen to me.
It might happen to you.
There is a possibility. There is a possibility. Sure. And as a minister, I think it's particularly challenging to ensure that you maintain your touch presence with the constituency.
And how do you juggle? You're not going to say how as a woman, but of course the question applies as well to men. How do you juggle the person and the man, which have been strong on you, overwhelming on you in terms of the loss of Anne Louise and now the coping with that, the constituency demand, the intellectual demands to have an hinterland other than politics, and the ministerial departmental demands?
The best way that I can answer that, I mean, I juggle that best if I ensure that I have enough quiet time and rest in my life.
Are you a better minister now than you were in April, May 2016?
Yes, I think so.
Why?
Because I've learned a lot. I feel I've got a lot of experience now with a lot of great people around me, a very strong department, and friends who also offer the advice. I think it's and I feel so with that confidence moving forward. But I suppose Noel, you know, the other thing I could say is that it is the experience, you know. But when you lose a spouse, and I was deeply in love with Anne-Louise for 36 years, it changes your perspective.
You and Anne-Louise have come to the Kennedy Summer School, I think, four times.
Yes.
I have a sense she's here with us, and we thank you for joining us this year. Thank you.